Hello everyone, this is tutorial number 13 for digital signal processing. In this tutorial, we will look at some questions on DFT and fast Fourier transform. So let me start with question number one. In this question, the question says that suppose that a computer program is available for computing the DFT, and this is basically the algorithm or the what the computer program is doing. It is computing the sequences gap x of k using xn, right, for k from 0 to n minus 1. So the input to the program is the sequence x of n, and the output is the DFT, which is gap x k. And it says show how the input and output sequences may be rearranged such that the program can also be used to compute the inverse DFT. So without making any changes to the computer program, we want to use the same program for computing the inverse DFT as well, which means that we want to compute xn given that cap xk is the input and n is from 0 to n minus 1. Okay. So let us look at the solution of this question. So it is given to us that this is how xk, cap xk is being calculated for k is from 0 to n minus 1. Now, first of all, we will use this program to compute this gn. This gn is nothing but the same expression that we have for computing the DFT with xk as the input. So using this computer program, first of all, we will compute this gn. Okay. And once we have done that, so you can see that this expression is the same of which the computer program is using for computing the DFT. So it can compute gn as well. And then we will use this gn to compute this term, which is 1 by n g n minus n modulo n for n going from 0 to n minus 1. And we will now show that when we do this, so once we have computed gn, we do this one extra step, and we are now going to show that this is the same as x of n, which means that this will produce the inverse DFT that we want. Okay, so this is our claim, and we are going to prove this. So if I write 1 by n g n minus n modulo cap n, that is nothing but summation from k 0 to n cap n minus 1 xk, because so basically what I'm doing is I'm substituting g n, which is this one here, in place of this expression, and in the power I'm replacing small n with cap n minus small n, right? And that is this term. So I have put it here, and this is what I'll get. Now I can also decompose this into two parts. One is with the power e raised to the power minus j 2 pi k cap n by cap n, and then positive j 2 pi k small n by cap n. So obviously the first part, which is cap n divided by cap n, will just become e raised to the power minus j 2 pi k, which is 1. So the second term will be this term over here. And if you note this expression, this is nothing but the inverse DFT of cap xk. And therefore, this part will actually be equal to x of n. So this is how we utilize the same computer program which was giving us the DFT to find out the inverse DFT. Okay. Going to the second question. In this question, we have been given this diagram, and this diagram is a graph representation or a signal flow graph representation of a decimation in time or a DIT FFT algorithm, and it is given that it is for cap n equals to 8. And it says that the heavy line shows a path from the sample x7 to cap x2, right? So there is this line, this highlighted line, which goes from x7 to cap x2. Okay, so this whole algorithm is actually nothing but the DFT of these sequences x0 to x7, and it will give me cap x0 to cap x7. That is, it will give me the DFT, right? And this is one particular highlighted line which shows us how x7 affects or contributes to cap x2. Okay. And so let's look at what the question says further. It says, what is the gain along the path that is emphasized in the figure? That is the highlighted one. So what is the gain along this path? So for any signal flow graph of this type, let me just, this is the complete graph. So whenever we have any signal flow graph of this type, we can find out the gains simply by multiplying all the gains that will lie in that particular path. So as you can see, from x7 to cap x2, the gains are, when there are nothing written over a particular path, then that means the gain is simply 1. So I'll just take the product of all the gains that are there, and that will be the total gain. So there is this w0 cap n and W2 cap n, and these are the only gains that are in this path. So I'll just take the product. W0 cap n is actually nothing but 1. So the overall gain will just become W2 cap n for this particular path. Coming to the second part, it says how many other paths in the signal flow graph begin at x7 and end at x2. Is this true in general? That is, how many paths are there between each input sample and each output sample? So this is something that you can realize from this graph, that if we look at cap x2, there are a number of paths from each of the sequences to cap x2. Let's say if we take an example of cap x2, then it is getting affected by all the sequences in the time domain. But there is only a single path that goes from one sequence to the DFT sequence. So there is no, for example, if I look at x7, there are no two paths that will go to cap x2 from x7. There is always a unique path. And that is the case with all the paths that CapX2 have, as with starting from each of these sequences. And that is true in general for any DFT algorithm. So for any DFT algorithm, we will note that that is the case, that there is a single unique path from the input to the output. There cannot be two paths from an input to the output. So that is the part two. And now let's look at the part three. So the part three says that, now consider the DFT sample CapX2. So we have to again consider CapX2. By tracing paths in the flow graph of the figure, show that each input sample contributes the proper amount to the output DFT sample. Okay, so well, first of all, let's just look at what is written for these two parts. So as you can see, in the first part, we had to find out the gain of the highlighted path, and that is nothing but minus WN2, right? That is what we saw, because there was also this minus 1. Okay, so it is WN0 minus 1 and WN2, which will give me minus WN2, right? So this was the part A. In part B, it says that in general, there is only one path between each input sample and each output sample, just like we discussed. Okay. And in the third part, it is asking us to compute CapX2, which is the DFT sample, by taking into consideration the contribution of each of the input sample. Okay, so basically, we just have to look at the gains in each of the path that is leading to x2, and then we will have to multiply that gain with that input. So let us start by looking at x0 and how it impacts capex2. So if we move along this line, starting from x0, if we move here, then we move down, and then we move straight, we will reach to capex2. You see that there is no other gain that is in this path. So the gain is simply one. So I can say that capex2 is affected by x0 through a gain of one. Similarly, let's look at capex1, which is down here. If I move from small x1, how small x1 contributes to capex2. So the path is so we move along this path, then we go down, move along this path, and then we go along this highlighted path. So you see, from moving from here, we only encountered a single gain, which is W2N. So for X0, the gain was one, and for X1, the gain is W2N. So if we look at the solution, so from X0, we have a gain one, and from X1, we have a gain W2N. In this way, we can also compute the gains from X2, starting from X2, up till all the points down to X7. So let us just also look at X7 and see if this is correct. So if we move from X7, which is this one, which was the highlighted path that we originally saw, there was WN0 minus one and WN2, right? We also saw this in the part A. So as you can see, there is minus WN0. So minus one is written here as minus WN0, right? And that will just give me minus WN2, right? So in this way, we can compute these gains. And then I can say that capex2 is basically xn product with each of these gains, right? Cap n is equal to 8 because we are taking 8-point DFT. Okay, and we will vary n from 0 to 7. Okay, and when I do this, so first of all, I will get so this is basically the DFT formula, right? And when I apply this and I expand this for each of the values of n, so for n equals to 0, I will get this part equal to 1. For n equals to 1, I'll get W2 in the subscript 8. Similarly, for n equals to 2, I'll get W4, 8, and so on, W6, 8, W8, 8, up till W14, 8, when I put n equals to 7. So these are the each of the coefficients that will be multiplied with x0 to x7. Now I can directly calculate these values because we know that these values are nothing but complex exponentials. So on solving this, I can substitute some of the values. So W84 will be equal to minus 1. W68 will be the same as minus W28. And similarly, W148 will be the same as minus W28, right? So this is the final expression that we get. And if we compare this expression and look at the gains that are multiplied with each of these x, we will see that these gains are exactly what we got from the signal flow graph. So with the first one, the gain is one. With x0, the gain is one. With x1, the gain is W2n, which is W28 here, and so on. So all these gains are exactly the same. So in this way, we have verified that what we will get through the signal flow graph is the same as what we will get through the formula. Okay. So this was question number two, and these kinds of questions are common for FFT algorithms. Coming to question number three, it says a designer has available a number of 8-point FFT chips. Show explicitly how he should interconnect three such chips in order to compute the 24-point DFT. So we have to take cap n equals to 24, and we have to divide the overall sequences into 8-point sequences so that we can implement it using an 8-point FFT chips. Okay. So let's look at how this will be done. So first of all, since we have to have three 8-point FFT chips, that means that the overall sequence of x0 or y0 to y cap n minus 1 must be divided into three subsequences of 8 points each. So that is why what we will do is we will take starting from, so there will be a cap n minus 1 will be equal to 23, and we will divide the overall sequence which we compute as a single summation and a product into three different subsequences. So in the first subsequence we take the element 0, and then we take every third element up till 21. In the second subsequence, we start with n equals to 1. And after selecting every third subsequence, we will go up to 22. And in the third subsequence, we start with n equals to 2. Again, selecting every third subsequence, we go up to 23, which is cap n minus 1. So in this way, we have covered the whole sequence as, and we have written it as the summation of three DFT expressions. And that will give me cap of yk. So upon solving this, first thing that we can do is we can take some I. Now, I is basically 0 to 7, because if we count the numbers which are in the summation, it will be equal to 7. So I have taken some I variable which goes from 0 to 7. And n is equal to 3i, so I have replaced this n with 3i here, because it will be selecting every third sequence of y, right? And here also n will be replaced by 3i, or I can say that n is replaced by I and cap n is replaced by cap n by 3, right? Similarly, for the second term, we start with n equals to 1. That is why I will replace n with 3i plus 1, so that when I equals to 0, I get y1 here. And again, 3i, because we are selecting every third sequence of y. And in w, we will have, first of all, n replaced by 3i, or I can say that n is replaced by I, and the 3 goes to the denominator of cap n. And there is this extra term wkn, which corresponds to this shift of 1. Okay, and finally, again, I will replace in this term I going from 0 to 7 instead of n. And inside here, n will be replaced by 3i plus 2. And there will be this term which corresponds to a shift of 2. And in this way, we can write this above expression. Okay. And if we write it more compactly, we can say that if this is some y1k, this term is y2k multiplied with yk cap n. So it is yk cap n multiplied with y2k. And this term is some y3k here, and multiplied with w2k cap n, which is this term. So the overall expression becomes something like this. And there, here y1, y2, and y3 represent the 8-point DFTs of the subsequences. So in this way, we have used 8 point FFT in order to compute the DFT of the 24 point sequence. Okay. Now coming to question number four. So in question number four, I have CAPEX K, which is an endpoint DFT of the sequence Xn. Xn is n is from 0 to cap n minus 1. And we define a 2n point sequence Yn, where Yn is equal to x n by 2 for even n's, and it is 0 for odd n's. And we have to express the 2n point DFT Yn in terms of Yxk. So first of all, we compute Yk, which is the DFT of this, and then we express it in terms of CapXk. Okay. So first of all, this is given to us that we have Xn, and its DFT is cap xk. N is going from 0 to cap n minus 1. K will also go from 0 to cap n minus 1. Then we compute this sequence yn, which is x n by 2 for even n's, and it is 0 for odd n's. Okay. So if I compute the DFT of yn, it will be given by n going from 0 to 2n minus 1. Yn wkn cap n, and k will also go from 0 to 2n minus 1. Now the reason n and k become go up to 2n minus 1 is because now, as compared to x, so if x has n number of samples, by doing this operation we are essentially adding a zero in between every value. So all the odd position there are zeros, and that is why we will have double the number of sequences in Y as compared to X, and that is why it will cap n is now 2 cap n, and so that's why n and k are going up till 2n minus 1. So this thing basically explains the same thing, that whenever we have xn, it is x naught to x cap n minus 1, and when we say x2n, we are essentially choosing every second element in Xn. And when we say Xn by 2, we are introducing a zero in between every sequence, right? That is what we mean when we say that we are downsampling or upsampling something, right? So this is just to recall. And now I have yk, which is like this. Now I can also write it as n going from 0 to cap n minus 1. Now n becomes even. So basically, by doing this, I do not have to go from up till 2n, because I have selected n such that it will only take the even value. So the number of n's will be reduced. And now once we have done this, so basically what we are trying to do is we are trying to make yk similar to this xk, so that we can find a relation between them. And in doing so, we now change this n is equal to summation from n is equal to 0 to 2n minus 1 to n equals to 0 to n minus 1, right? So what we can do is we can introduce some m which goes from 0 to cap n minus 1, and we can say that here instead of n we can have y of 2m. So it is basically like selecting only the even or non-zero parts of y, and so this n will be replaced by m, which is going from 0 to cap n minus 1. Similarly here also we will have n replaced by m, and in fact n will be replaced by 2m, and this 2 will get cancelled out with this 2, so we will get this expression. Okay, and since we have taken y at 2m, which means that that is nothing but canceling out the effect of this term, right? When we originally took y, we added zeros, but by doing this, we are only taking into consideration the non-zero values. So this y2m is nothing but x of m. And so this is the expression that we will obtain for yk, which is nothing but xk for k in 0 to n minus 1. And that is the relation between yk and xk, that yk is basically xk for k from 0 to n minus 1. We can also say that this is xk minus n, which is the shifted version of x from k going from n to 2n minus 1. And that's the relation between y and x. Okay. With that, we reach the final question, which is question number 5. Okay. So in this question, we again have an 8-point, we again have a diagram given to us, which is something like this. Let me just show you the diagram first. So the diagram is like this. You can see that this is an 8-point DFT or an 8-point FFT algorithm, right? These sequences, which are represented by A, are the inputs, and D are the outputs. So in the output, we will have the DFT of the input sequence. And the values at these nodes, we will represent by B, and the values at these nodes, we will represent by C. So starting with part A, so first of all, let's read the question. It says the figure below shows the signal flow graph for an 8-point decimation in time FFT algorithm. So it's an 8-point cap n equals to 8, and it is decimation in time. Let xn be the sequence whose DFT is cap xk. In the flow graph, A, B, C, and D represent separate arrays that are indexed consecutively in the same order as the indicated nodes. So first of all, it says specify how the elements of the sequence xn should be replaced in the array AR. Also specify how the elements of the DFT sequence should be extracted from the array DR, which is R going from 0 to 7. So it basically means that we have to find out how should we place the elements of small xn here, and how should we obtain the elements of cap x, which is the DFT, from the output. So this is a decimation in time FFT, and we will see how to place elements in the inputs and how to obtain from the outputs. So the way we do it is something that is called the bit reversal method. So we say that for decimation in time DFT, the input data is obtained. So the sequence in which we must put the input data is obtained by this method, which is called bit reversal method, which we will discuss now. And talking about the output, which is the DFT sequence, is simply obtained in a sequential order, which means that we just take the corresponding to each of the sequence or each of the k value, we directly obtain the output. So if we have 8-point decimation, which means that the xn is x0 to x7, right? So if I write in the first column the decimals going from 0 to 7, clearly to represent this in a memory, we see that 8 is basically 2 cube, which means that 3 bits of memories will be required to store these elements in binary. So corresponding to these elements, I will write the 3 bit of the binary numbers. So 0 corresponds to 000, 1 corresponds to 0, 0, 1, and so on till 7, which is 1, 1, and 1. So this is just the binary representation of these decimals. Then now we will write a bit reversed order for these memory addresses. So how will we get this? We just replace, we just reverse these digits. So here 000 will simply be 000. For 001, I'll reverse this, so it will become 100. This will 010 will also remain the same. 011 will become 110. 100 on reversal will become 00 and 1. And in this way, we have basically just reversed the bit order and obtained this new memory address. Now, once we have done this, we can obtain the new address in decimal corresponding to this memory address. So we say that 000, obviously this remains the same. So the decimal corresponding to this will be 0. Corresponding to 100, we will have, so 100 was corresponding to 4. So this is 4. 010 will be the same, so it is 2. 110 is 6. So 6 is here. So in this way, corresponding to these memory addresses, I will get this new address in decimal. And this is the order in which I will supply my input to this FFT algorithm. So I will say that the inputs A0 to A7 will actually be X0, X4, X2, X6, and so on up till X7. And these decimals are chosen on the basis of this new address. And this is the bit reversal technique through which we have obtained the order in which the inputs must be, input sequence must be supplied to this FFT decimation in time algorithm. Then talking about the output, so the output should be extracted from DR in the sequential order. So we do not have to worry like this for the output. Output will simply be XK. So when we have to obtain this DFT, it will simply be corresponding to DK, which means that from D0, I will obtain X0, and from D1, I will obtain X1, and so on. So there is the obtaining the output is quite simple. It is straightforward. It is a sequential order. So this was part one on how to obtain the elements of the sequence and how to extract the output. Now, in the second part, it says that without determining the values of the in the intermediate arrays B and C, we have to determine the sketch, determine and sketch array sequence DR R from 0 to 7 if the input sequence is this. So we have been given the input sequence. We have to compute the output without having to determine the B and C. So that means that we do not have to use the signal flow graph, but we have to use the formula. And the input is given as this. Okay. So yeah, this is part B, starting from here. Oh, wait. Okay, there is a bit of problem in the order, but here is the part B. So we have been given that Xn is this. This is the input, and we have to compute cap Xk just by using the DFT formula. N goes from 0 to cap n minus 1, which is 7. This is the input minus W 8 raised to the power n. And this is W8NK, which is the complex exponential. Now, I can break this into two parts, minus 1 raised to the power N and W8 raised to the power N. Minus 1 raised to the power N can be written as W minus 4 cap n equals to 8 raised to the power n. We are doing so that we can write all the terms in the form of, in terms of this wn 8, right? So this is what this minus 1 will become. And then we can just add their powers. That will be minus 4n plus n plus nk. So it will be minus 3n plus nk. That is n times k minus 3. So cap xk is this part. And this can also be written as 1 minus w k minus 3. So in the numerator, we will multiply by cap n. So the 8 gets cancelled out because cap n is 8. So 8 in the numerator and denominator will cancel out. And in the denominator, sorry, in the powers, right? So here in this part, when we multiply the power with cap n, the cap n in the denominator of the power will cancel out. And in the denominator, I'll just write w k minus 3, and in cap n is 8, right? Because small n will be simply 1 here. And this is how we can write this expression. And this is nothing but 8 del k minus 3, which is the delta function with n equals to 3. Right, so this is what cap xk is, and this will be the output. So we can also plot this because it is asked to draw a sketch. So the sketch for this will be, or the sketch for dr will be, because dr is the output, it will be a value of 8 at n equals to 3. So at n equals to 3, we have a value of 8, and all the other values are 0. So this is what cap xk or dr is, right? R is from 0 to 7. So this way we have computed the output using the DFT formula without having to solving the intermediate arrays, without using the signal flow graph. Okay, finally coming to the last part, it says determine and sketch the sequence CR, R from 0 to 7, if the output Fourier transform is cap xk is equal to 1 for k equals to 0 to 7. So we have been given the output and we have to compute CR. So coming to the diagram, this is what C is here, and we have been given the outputs, which are 1. So all the outputs are 1 and we have to compute C's. Okay. So, well, this is also quite straightforward since we know the outputs. So first of all, it's given that the output cap xk is equal to 1 for all k from 0 to 7. First of all, we will find out a relation between D and C, right? So for that, we will need to look at the diagram. So for example, if we look at D0, which is nothing but cap x0, sorry, not this one, this one, D0, which is nothing but cap x0, it is actually the sum of, so we have to write it in terms of the inputs, right? So using the diagram, we will write it, we will show how it is related to C's. Okay, so these are the C's and these are D's. So C times the weights will give me D0. Okay, so D0 will be equal to C0, and this term C4 multiplied with WN0, because these are the two terms that are going directly to D0. This one and this one is following this path. Since W0N is nothing but 1, we can simply say that D0 is C0 plus C4. Similarly, we can find D1, which will be C1 plus, through this line, we have C5 times W1N. Similarly, D2 will be C2 times c2 plus c6 times w2n, and so on. So in this way, we can find out all the d's in terms of c's. And once we do that, we will get these terms. So this is d0, d1, d2, d3, d4, and this is d5, 6, and 7. So once we have obtained these terms, we will say that we have 7 equations, system of equations, and we are the question asks that we have to find out c's in terms of d, right? We have to represent c in terms of the output. So for that, we have to make c the subject of these equations. So we have to simultaneously solve these 8 equations to find out cr. And once we do that, these are the 8 equations that we will obtain. You can verify them. These are simply algebraic equations, and we just have to make c is the as the subjects. So these are the set of equations that we will get for r in 0 to 7. And since in the previous question we calculated what, we know that d0 to d7 are all 1, right? That is given to us in the question. So we can actually calculate the value of c's. We can plot c versus r going from 0 to 7. So since, let's say, d0 is 1 and this is also d4 is also 1, c0 will become 1. And C1, C2, C3 will also become 1. And similarly, we can compute all of them, and we can plot them, and the sketch will look like this. So in the sketch, values 0, 1, 2, and 3 are 1, and rest of the values are 0. So this is the sketch of the CR array, which we have computed based on the output, which is DR. And with this we reach the end of the last question. So these are generally the type of questions that are asked from this FFT algorithms and DFT. And so with that, we reach the end of this tutorial. Thank you.